Welcome, everybody.
Thank you very much for the invitation.
Okay, so let us start. Do you guys know what fake news is? Let's do a little bit of a test. Is this fake news? Who thinks this is fake news? Okay. So, okay, it's something that says, oh, Obama is banning Christmas cards to the military because it can be offensive to Muslims. Okay? Okay, this actually is a fake news. Okay? How about this one?
Can you guys hear me better? No?
Okay, yep. So, is this fake news? Well, that's something funny, right? It's something satire. Well, it depends, okay? Under most definitions of fake news, this is not fake news, okay? According to Facebook, this is satire, and satire is protected speech. So, kind of Facebook, when it tries to fight the fake news, they'll do something about the things like that, okay? But they would not do something like for things like that. Why is that? Well, the main difference is that the first one, this one is a political weapon. This one is weaponized. This one is just funny, okay? That's a big difference. So, okay, what is fake news? Well, fake news is an oxymoron. It's an internal contradiction. News is supposed to be true, okay? So, I don't like the term fake news, and I can tell you that at the European Union level, people talk about disinformation. Disinformation has a much more clear definition. It is something that is both false and it also means harm, okay? It's weaponized. This is the main problem of the fake news. If you guys are going to remember one thing of this talk, it should be that the main problem of fake news is not that it's false. This is secondary. The main problem is that it's weaponized, okay? It's targeting. Can be targeting a country, can be targeting a politician, can be targeting a celebrity, can be targeting a company, okay? It's used as a weapon. This is why we worry about it. Don't worry about something that just it's false. It can be false because it's funny, it can be false because it doesn't matter. I mean, but when it's used as a weapon, this is why we worry about. This is why we started worrying about this in 2016, okay? So, fake news is a weapon of mass deception, okay? So, this is why we worry. And you know, I didn't come across a good definition of fake news, but there are things, there are kind of elements that are probably important. One is that it's viral, one is that it spreads over social media, one is that it is weaponized, one that it can be really, really designed, this is what Cambridge Analytica did, to target specific users based on our psychological profiles, based on our location, based on our demographics, and so on and so forth. So basically, somebody can create news designed exactly for you, designed to press a specific button on you, okay? And this is why we worry about it. It's about technology. There has been false information, there has been tabloids, and so on and so forth. For a long time, it was not a problem. But now it's a matter of scale. I like to say that fake news is like spam on steroids. If I spam, the difference is that if I send a spam to 1,000 people, it ends there. If I send a really viral message to 1,000 people, it can eventually reach millions, okay? And then, of course, before the US elections, there was the Brexit, which was affected by fake news. And it's not only political. Here, I had some conversations yesterday. It turns out that here in Vietnam, companies worry a lot about this, about attacks on their reputation, okay? Can be by rivals, can be by users, and so on and so forth, okay? And then it has financial aspects. So this was back in 2013. This was 3 years before we started worrying about the fake news. Okay, because this was 2016, since we start worrying about this, Syrian hackers hacked the Twitter account of Associated Press and put there the message, two explosions in the White House and Barack Obama is injured. What happened? $136 billion were erased on a stock exchange. $136 billion. Of course, then it jumped back, but somebody could have made money in between. And I can tell you that this is a very, very significant event because the vast majority of the news that we read today come from three sources, Associated Press, France Press, and Reuters, okay? And hacking one of them, that's a major thing. And then it has health implications. So UNICEF is blaming 300% rise on the measles outbreak because of fake news. And actually, four European countries are no longer measles-free, okay, including UK. And then in India, people get literally killed because of fake news. Okay, somebody has this fake news, this guy has done this, and then a mob goes and kills him. And that's a big problem. Okay? And actually, fake news can cause things of much larger scale. According to an official UN investigation, the crisis with Rohingya, okay, which is a major crisis, started with fake news. Okay? And so on and so forth. So Tim Berners-Lee has been complaining that, you know, his invention has been weaponized. Okay, let me ask you a question. Is crowdsourcing the solution to fake news? So Elon Musk thought so. He said, okay, you know what? I'm going to create a website and where everybody can go and rate every single journalist, every single news outlet, every single article, and so on and so forth. Everybody goes there and votes. And then we're going to know what's quality and what is not, okay? Sounds good. Well, journalists destroyed him about this idea. I mean, that's the worst idea ever. You know, Elon, he doesn't know how journalism works, but he wants to fix it and some stuff like that, okay? Why is that? Well, the problem is people don't recognize the fake news. They don't, okay? There was a recent study that, so this is Maria Gabriel, this is the European Commissioner in charge of fighting disinformation at the European Union level, and she has been talking about this study, that 75% of people don't recognize the fake news, okay? And then just because, there's another problem, just because the majority of people believe in something doesn't mean it's true, okay? So earlier this year, there was a study that shows that 57% of Russians, or 75 depending on how you count the answer to a multiple choice question, don't believe that Americans were on the moon, okay? Now, let me put this into perspective. When it actually happened in the condition of very bad Cold War situation, okay, there was absolutely no doubt in the Soviet Union that the Americans did it. They officially congratulated the Americans. Not only that, they invited Armstrong to go to Moscow. Not only that, he went, okay? There were, you know, interviews and stuff. I mean, there was absolutely no doubt. But today, you know, Russians don't believe it, okay? And then, you know, you can hack those kind of things. There has been proposals. So we're going to do, you know, blockchain, and we are going to fix the problem in this way. Well, you know, those people that do manipulation, maybe they have deep pockets, maybe can take control of the network and rewrite history. And this has already happened to Ethereum Classic. Okay, next question. Can fact-checking solve the problem of fake news? Okay, this is what many people believe. We are going to do fact-checking and we are going to fix it. And actually there has been a lot of work of manual fact-checking and automatic fact-checking of claims, okay? So this is a claim, you know, by Elon Musk that got him into a lot of trouble. This is a claim, okay? There are rumors. The difference is that rumors is not clear where they come from. There is no author. Oh, Vladimir Putin is dead and somebody else is, you know, ruling Russia or something, okay? And you know, or entire articles. So for example, this article says, oh, a little bit before Obama was stepping down, he was speaking to the military and he said, why don't you guys do a coup d'etat against Trump, okay? Of course, this is fake, but you know, and you know, those two are weaponized, okay? Well, the question is, can you fact check every single claim in the world? Okay, and let me put this a little bit into perspective because recent technology from this year, there have been two very powerful fake news generators that you can go and you can check yourself. You can also take a quiz whether you can recognize them, right? And this is something that people are worrying a lot. So two weeks ago, I was at a security conference in Doha, and there was an FBI agent that was talking about that he has copies of those two and they're analyzing them and so on and so on. I mean, you can generate news very, very fast. And then fake news, there was a recent study by MIT Media Lab last year that fake news travels 6 times faster than real news. A little bit less known study, but I believe much more important is this one that shows that 50% of the lifetime spread of some viral fake news happens in the first 10 minutes. In the first 10 minutes, there's no time to react. How can you fact check manually, even automatically? How do you fact check automatically? Where we compare to previously kind of fact check claim, probably it has not been checked before. You compare to what mainstream media write about it. There's no time for mainstream media to write, okay? And or you monitor the reactions of users in social media. There's no time for them to react. So there's no time. What can you do? So our answer is to look at the source. Where is it coming from, okay? So we are, of course, you can see, are those trustworthy users in social media? We are looking primarily in mainstream media. Because if you put a false claim, you probably put a link to a website where there is the article, and you don't create a new website for every single fake false claim that you make. You're going to reuse, which means that we can see what those websites are, and we can monitor them, and we can be ready. Basically, we can profile them in advance. And this is why I say that you can fact check the fake news before it was even written. Because the moment when it's written, the moment when you put a link to a website, we can go and say, oh, we know this website. It's not very trustworthy. Okay? Okay, another question. Too many questions today. Can we win the war on fake news? Okay, I believe we can. But so early this year, I was speaking to the Inter-Parliamentary Assembly. It's something where there are 800 members of parliament from 180 countries. And for 3 hours, three people, we have been asking their questions, and they were interested, what kind of legislation can we, you know, have to fix the problem of fake news once and for all? Well, the answer was it's not so simple. It's a complex problem. There is no simple solution. Okay? You want the social media companies to monitor, kind of they're in the best position to limit the spread in their platforms. Governments, they can do some legislation, for example, certain kind of hate speech is illegal. Okay? And then you need fact checkers, but also we as technology, we can actually help that. Okay, and there are indications, so the thing that I think works best is education. And there have been, this was everywhere in the news, that this actually works. So Finland is winning the war on fake news. So how they did this? Well, through education. Back in 2014, after Russia annexed Crimea, Finland got very scared and they started a massive education campaign, telling people what fake news is, how they can detect it, and so on and so forth, developing critical thinking. And of course, Finland is a country with a lot of media illiteracy. This is a map of Europe. So there's nothing new under the sun. So Joseph Goebbels, he's the minister of propaganda of the Nazi Germany, he was saying that propaganda becomes ineffective the moment we are aware of it. So basically, if you educate people, if they learn to recognize it, well, they are not going to be affected by it that much. They're also probably not going to share it so much, so it's not going to be viral. If I don't share it, it doesn't reach those 2,000 users in my network, and so on and so forth. So we can eventually limit its impact. And this is what we do in the Tambi mega project. So there are three unique, this is something that we develop in collaboration with MIT. You can go, you can try it. I plan to, you know, to show you a little bit at the end. So we have, there are three unique characteristics about this. First, we put this technology into a news aggregator. Okay, so that as you read the news, we signal to you whether this is likely to be propaganda. We give you background about the media, so that you understand, you know, what are the biases and the factuality of reporting of those media. And then we also offer you explainability. If we tell you, oh, this is not a good medium, you're going to ask me why, okay? We can actually show you, we can show you the specific propaganda techniques in context. Okay, so this is how it looks like. So as you read, it actually signals to you that something is likely to be propaganda, and you can actually also click here and get information about the medium. And I'm going to show you shortly. And you get like something like that. Okay, how do we do it? So what we do is, we do this, how much time do I have? 20 minutes, okay, I'm good. So what we do is, we are looking into, primarily into what media write. This is the most important thing. But we are also looking into what is there in their social media profiles, what is there about them in Wikipedia, also what people say about them in social media, some traffic information from Alexa Rank, the structure of their URL, and so on and so forth, and we put all these things together. And I'm going to give you some examples. Okay? So, first of all, what they write. Okay? So, something about the... It's not easy to write fake news. Okay? You kind of to make up a story, you are probably going to write something short or something repetitive. Then the language is different. You need to appeal to people's emotions. You probably want to have a simple message and so on and so forth. You are looking for sentiment, for bias, for subjectivity, for discussion of moral categories like religion, war, and other divisive topics. Also, is there a connection between the title and the abstract and the article? Because clickbait, there is no such connection. Wikipedia. So what is there in Wikipedia? Is there, first of all, is there a Wikipedia page? If there is not, this is already kind of a negative signal. So here you see, oh, it's a semi-emergently conservative editorial magazine. Conservative in Western politics means right-leaning, okay? It tells you something about the bias of the medium, potentially about its factuality, because I'm going to show you later that it's okay to be biased, but if you are very biased, then you are kind of not very factual. And then Twitter, okay? So is there a Twitter account in the first place? Is it old? Is it not? Is it popular? Is it verified? And then we are looking into how they self-describe, okay? Look here, an army combat vet, NCO, crusader, republican, take back our country, MAGA, America first. So from this, you can conclude this is a right-leaning user. This is how they self-describe. This is very, very precious. Another thing, okay, this is not just a user, this is a medium. Why there is no connection to the website? You should be crazy if you are a news outlet not to have a link to your website from Twitter, right, from your Twitter account. The same thing, okay, so URLs, look here. AngryPatriotMovement.com, 100% fed up, Alternative Media Syndicate. Those are not serious names. You don't name like this a serious medium, okay? Or abcnews.com.co, okay? I mean, it's clear what's going on. You're trying to masquerade as something else. And some web traffic. Then what we are looking at the YouTube profiles of media, okay? So we are looking not only at what they say, but how they say it. Is there a lot of emotion? So kind of you are analyzing the sound, you are analyzing the speech, you are analyzing the language, okay? And then we're looking into the audience. Who reads them? So for example, Fox News, okay? Who reads Fox News? And this information that you can get from Facebook. So Facebook is analyzing each of us. It's profiling each of us, tracking us on different websites and so on and so forth. And they know whether we are liberal or conservative. And this is information that they expose to their advertisers. So anybody can go and get this information if you're an advertiser, because I might want to sell to conservative users that like Fox News, for example, okay? And you can see how big this base is, okay? And this is something that you can actually get from there. And then we are also looking into the bias of media on specific topics. Like for example, and this is based on Twitter. So basically we go on Twitter on a polarizing topic, we have a few million tweets, we see who are the most active users, who are on this side of the debate, who are on that side of the debate, and then we try to see whether they are going to put a link to the target medium, in this case RT, you know, in the context of this debate. And then based on this, you see that RT is a very interesting medium. So they kind of have support both from left and right causes, and this is something typical of media that try to, you know, divide the society, okay? This is one of the things that people worry about. And how well does it work? Well, okay, those are unpublished results, but I can't have a link to another work. But so we get about 80% in terms of factuality, and in terms of 75% in terms of bias, left, center, right. And this is based only on the content of the articles. And then you can see that the social media information doesn't really help you much on factuality. It does reasonably well in terms of bias. And if you put the things into an ensemble, you can get to 80% also for bias. So kind of about 80% for actuality, about 80% for bias. And then there's a connection between left center, between how biased you are and how factual you are. So the most factual media, right, are not biased. The most biased media are not factual, okay? So based on this, you can actually do a joint learning, multitask learning, where you're trying to predict bias and factuality together, and also centrality, hyperpartisanship. And this actually can reduce your error, right, for factuality, if you also take into account bias and centrality and extremism. Now let me move to another topic, the topic of propaganda, okay? So unlike fake news, propaganda has a very clear definition. There might be the variations, but there are two key factors. One is that you are trying to influence people, and the second that you do it on purpose, okay? Now, the difference from fake news and kind of from disinformation, in disinformation, you mean harm. In propaganda, you don't necessarily mean harm. Propaganda can be also good, okay? I can have propaganda to try to convince you to vaccinate your children, and that's good, okay? So, yeah, we had some work on trying to predict propaganda at the article level. right? And we are showing this into the media profiles that we do, that for example, for Breitbart, that big part of its content is very likely to be propaganda, okay? And we also signal this in our application. But if you really want to offer explainability, you want to go to the specific techniques through which propaganda is done. For example, one technique is name calling, you see here on the left. Another one is bandwagon. Bandwagon is, oh, 57% of people say we are going to vote for Clinton, okay, which means that we are on the winning side of history. Better come, you know, and join us, right? This is kind of one technique, it's bandwagon. Okay, again, as I said, propaganda can be good. So here, you know, Greta is saying, okay, there's mass extinction and so on and so forth, but kind of what she's trying to do is she's trying to scare us. Okay, this appeal to fear. This is a propaganda technique. Okay, and we have been looking into 18 propaganda techniques, and then half of them are some kind of appeal to emotions, appeal to authority, and so on and so forth. Another half are logical fallacies, things like you're either with us or against us. Or, for example, I don't know, oh, you're a vegetarian? You know who else who's vegetarian? Hitler. Okay, and somehow this implies that, you know, it's bad to be vegetarian, which in a logical sense doesn't make any sense, right? But those are kinds of techniques through which we are being manipulated. So what we did was we sat down, we hired a company to annotate 350,000 words and with the use of specific propaganda techniques in text, and then we trained a model. I don't have time to go in detail, but it's based on BERT, which is kind of state-of-the-art model, where we do multitask learning, where we predict for each word whether it's part of one of those 18 propaganda techniques or not, and also whether the sentence is interesting or not. I'm going to skip the results. And finally, before I show you the actual app, I want to show you, to tell you that we are applying these things also to media, okay? So we have been working together with Al Jazeera, Associated Press, and RT Ireland, and it's a problem that mainstream media are interested in. They're interested in self-monitoring. They're interested in knowing whether their content is factual, whether they are biased on specific topics, or in general, and so on and so forth. And we have been working for 9 months with them and together with other partners like Tech Mahindra, Metaliquid, and Vinova in trying to help them understand kind of, you know, self-monitor their content and find out whether they are compliant with the legislation of the country and with the internal rules of their organization. And so kind of some things from the demos that we have developed, for example, you upload a video and it tells you, oh, here he's saying something that has been previously fact-checked and we know is false, okay? And this is something you can imagine, you know, as you're interviewing somebody, you know, imagine it tells you, oh, he's now saying, I mean, look, suppose you're interviewing somebody and it tells you, oh, it's 85% likely that he's now saying that, you know, lying. Well, we are not going to put the politician on the spot based on that unless there's explainability, and we actually offer explainability. Okay? And this is something where you can upload something, it tells you whether it's left or right, kind of you get the bias because they want to know what percent of their content is biased. And here's another thing. Here, this truck is going to hit the people in this kind of graphic content, we detect this as well. And we can do this because we have APIs. So basically we have developed APIs so that everybody can use this. Basically, we have propaganda at the article level, at the sentence level, this kind of fine-grained propaganda that I'm going to show you in a minute. Bias, left, center, right. Checkworthiness, which is you can upload an article, it can tell you those are the 5 or 10 claims that are really, really suspicious, and if you're a fact-checking journalist, go and check those first. For example, imagine a presidential debate just finished, and you can tell you, oh, check this, this, and this, okay? And then the actual fact-checking. Okay, so let me actually quickly show you the demo. Oh, there's a mouse, oh, great, okay. Okay. Let's see, okay. So this is Tambi. Okay. So Tambi is a news aggregator, okay? So as you read, okay, the mouse is not very responsive. Okay, so basically it tells you that this specific article is likely to be propaganda, okay? Okay. Sorry? Okay, it works. Yes, thank you. And yeah, so and I can actually go and see the bias of specific medium. So for example, I can click here, okay, and it's going to tell me this is BBC. It's going to tell me this is all automatic profile. It's going to tell me it's central. It's not hyper-partisan. And then is it likely to be propaganda? You see only 1.5% propaganda in BBC and 95.8% clean content. This is very different from some other sites. Okay, then this is the general frame of reporting. You know, any conflict, let's say, I don't know, can be the Hong Kong protests or can be the Brexit and so on and so forth, has different aspects. There is a political aspect, there is an economic aspect, there is a legal aspect, there is a human rights aspect, there is quality of life aspect, there is cultural identity aspect and so on and so forth. And we are looking from which perspective the reporting is being done. And then this is the factuality of reporting based on all these kind of source of information that I was talking about. And then this is their leading political ideology. Is it left, center, or right? Okay. And you can see it on a, also on a 7-point scale. This is their audience. You see that there is a little bit of left bias. And this is their bias on specific topics, like immigration or gun control, and you see some left bias. And then here, you can actually profile them with respect to specific claims, like why climate change is a flat-out hoax. They actually disagree very strongly with this claim, and so on and so forth. And maybe I can show you. Okay. Maybe I can show you some other one. Okay, let me show you Fox News, for example. Well, maybe I should have sent Breitbart, but I don't really have. Okay, I cannot type. Okay, so there is a little bit kind of more propaganda, and it's primarily political, and then there's kind of some mixed factuality, and then it's right bias, and you see that their audience is kind of right, and here we have right. Let me show you something else. This is explainability, okay? We have 10 minutes. Wow, okay. Well, I have finished my talk too fast because there was no indication. Wow, okay. Then I guess I have, okay. Then I can show you a little bit more, okay? Let me show you a little bit more. Okay. Right, okay. So let me show you CNN, for example, okay? So again, it's kind of central, not much propaganda, not really political, kind of primarily cultural identity, somewhat trustworthy. There's left bias, but it's primarily center. There's some left bias in their audience and kind of left bias here. Let me show you some, let's say, Mail Online. And of course, you can type here, but I don't have a keyboard, so I cannot type there. But, okay, so this is Mail Online. Okay, there's somewhat a bit more propaganda about this. And then, you know, factuality of reporting is not very high, and so on and so forth. Okay, I want to show you the fine-grained propaganda, and then probably I can, I want to show you something else, but I don't have access to a computer, but let me show you. So basically what we do is, here is a specific topic, let's say gun control, but actually it's maybe better if I can. Can you type here? Okay, let me type. Can you type? Okay. Oh, you cannot type? I don't know, Brexit. Yeah, Brexit. Yeah. Okay. Mm-hmm. So this is analysis of an entire event with respect to different media writing about it. And basically we show on a map who talks about Brexit, where propaganda comes from, right? We can see what are the top reporting countries in absolute and relative numbers, where propaganda comes from, in absolute and relative numbers, and the same for media. What are the top reporting media? What are the top propagandistic media? And then you can have here how propagandistic this topic is. And then you see that Brexit is primarily discussed from a political perspective, by far, okay? And then here you can see the top, the over-reporting media. So this is the average reporting. And you see that BBC, Mail Online, Guardian, which are British media, of course, overreported by a lot. If you look at something like, I don't know, let's say Al Jazeera, it reports it about average. If you look at something like, let's say, Al Arabiya, they don't care, right? I mean, something that you probably expect. Can we put here, let's say, Sri Lanka, space. Uh-huh, okay. So, this is Sri Lanka bombings, okay? And yeah, the same thing. So there's a little bit more propaganda about this, but see, it's not political this time, it's about cultural identity and crime and punishment and morality and things like that. This is the perspective from which is being reported. Can you put here vaccines, V-A-C-C, V-A? Okay, yeah, that's enough, yeah. You should come. Okay, it doesn't come, well. Okay, let me move on. I mean, basically, if you have vaccine, well, or maybe erase it and try. Yeah, try, just type, try. Yeah, okay. Okay, let's see. So this is vaccination, and you see much more propaganda about it. The clean content is not that much, and see the perspectives is health and safety, okay? Which is something that you can expect. And the last thing that we have, okay, well, we have other things. So for example, we have browser plugin, which you can install and you can get access to those things. We have APIs, as we said. But this is, let's say, in the topic of gun control and gun rights, you can see where propaganda comes from, what are the top propaganda media, and what are the specific techniques being used. But we actually can even show those in context. I don't know, I can look at, I don't know, let's say here. Okay, so those are the specific propaganda techniques, and we show you what is going on. Yes. Oh. Here? Okay, let's see. I don't know if I have Vietnamese media, okay? Try here, VN, but I don't think I have it. VN, okay, no. Sorry. Next time. Okay. So, okay. Right. Okay, so basically we are showing to people the specific propaganda techniques that are being used, okay? Kind of things like worded language and causal oversimplification, or I don't know, I can look at, right? So the idea is that this is something that is going, okay, it's a murder and the war works, and so on and so forth. So basically this is something that can teach people, can show them how propaganda happens. Yeah. So Democrats think. There's a lot of cried wolf, and so on and so forth. So basically, you can learn about the specific use of those propaganda techniques. And I can tell you that after having interacted a little bit with a tool like this, I cannot personally read the news properly anymore. I see those techniques everywhere. And the point is not for you to go there and check every single news, oh, let's see if there's propaganda or not. The point is to develop critical thinking so that you understand, so that you can like start detecting. And at least to me, it has happened. So now that I read the news, I always see those kind of techniques. Okay, thank you.